Hello everyone, my name is Andrew Nobbins and this is walkthrough number 8 of my virtual reality project featuring the sets from Space 1999. This is a relatively minor update and it mainly deals with the addition of some additional props that I've added to this main mission set and one major prop that I've added to the launch pads. So, as has been tradition in the past, let's start off the walkthrough by looking at the globe. So here we have our standard Earth globe from the TV show, and as you may remember, I have an option in the menu to choose a moon globe, and so I have tweaked the moon globe one more time for this version. Probably the main difference is that I've removed, we used to have these black outlines around all the little craters. I've removed those and I've kind of enhanced the busyness of the craters in the texture. So if I just spin that and move away a little bit, you get a feel for what it looks like. And as before, this is based on the height map that I got from NASA website, and then just done some Photoshop tweaking to it. The main aim of the texture is to give it that sort of stylized, cartoony feel that we see from the original Earth globe texture that was used on the TV show. So that was a minor change that I made to the texture there. One of the other props that I've added is this little dock for the comlock. It's just a very simple bit of geometry, but that was in the TV show, and the way that the comlock fits into it, it kind of looks quite nice. So I've added one of those here, and then I've also put it into the reception desk down at the other end of the corridor. Now, the other prop that I've added to this main mission set is this clipboard. This is a Hewer timing board from the 1970s that was used in the TV show. And I have to give credit to Georgia from Canada, who emailed me some photos of this timing board and the stopwatches and so on. I wouldn't have even attempted to do this without those photos, so thanks for that. But now let's just take a look at the timing board in detail. And I'll use the feature where I grab the world with the two trigger buttons and then move the world up and down. And that's how I'll get myself closer to the object that I'm inspecting. So on the timing board, on this clipboard, you can see I've got a picture, and here this is actually a picture of the plan that I have drawn for the main mission set. My workflow usually starts off by drawing two-dimensional plans and sections, and then from there I do the 3D modeling. So this is the 2D plan that I generated to model this environment. So that's just a bit of trivia there. But anyway, so back to the timing board. So there were different variants of the timing board. And in the TV show, the photos are always a little bit blurry in the actual TV show. But there were slightly different versions of this board and you know, different curves and that sort of stuff. So, but this is one that seemed to be most common. So the Hewer stopwatches themselves. I'm still a little bit of a loss as to how this actually worked in terms of timing. It was used for timing car races, I guess. I don't know what the whole, how it was supposed to work. I mean, I guess you've got three watches here. I've only shown two because I wanted to show the interior detail of the clipping mechanism without a stopwatch in place. But basically, I mean, you can see here this lever would activate and deactivate the clocks at the same time. But why do you need it three and how that worked? I don't know how the whole mechanism is supposed to work. In the TV show, I think I saw some bull clips. It's been a while since I modelled this, so I don't actually remember the details, but it seemed appropriate to put these little ball clips on. I like how they turned out. Simple thing, but it adds to the whole feel of the thing. Now, these in this environment, we can't pick things up and interact with them because it's using baked lighting and all that sort of stuff. I've explained this before, but in the diorama scene, we will be able to pick up this clipboard and inspect it from all angles and so on. So I've added the clipboard, and I've added one over here. In fact, I've added the same red clipboard over here as well. But this white clipboard has got a different piece of paper on it. And so this is, again, like I said, I draw plans and elevations of the things that I model. And so the Eagle Transporter, these are my plans and elevations of the 3D model of the Eagle Transporter that I did. And again, a different sort of book configuration there. So, and you might remember from previous walkthroughs, in this location I did have these plastic covered bits of paperwork, but I removed those. I was having trouble with the geometry intersecting and all that sort of stuff, so it was a good idea to remove that from there and put this clipboard here. So that's the props here in Main Mission. Now let's just go to the corridor and just see how those props placed in here. And I think I have the com lock prop that I added to this desk, but with no com lock because there is no person here in reception. And then I added over here in the travel tube, I've added a random clipboard just sitting there. Somebody left it behind, so that was added to this region. Now, I'll go back to Main Mission, and this next little addition is not so much a prop, but more a environmental change. So in the TV show, we have these white panels on the wall. And in fact, if I bring up the screen captures, so the screenshots from the TV show, and you can see, remember these from before, that they just shots from the TV show placed in their correct position and the correct perspective and all that sort of stuff. And then so in some of these shots you can see there's a white illuminated wall panels, but there are other cases where we have different colored illuminated wall panels. And here's an example. Here's an example of the green wall panels, and then later on we'll see some peach-coloured ones and so on. So the change that I made, in fact I'll turn off these things for now, the change that I made, or the addition that I made, is we now have some new menu options. So here we have wall light diffusers. White is the default, and then we have red, peach, orange, and green. Now, before I show you these different colored options, I just want to point out that it is a bit of a fudge. The lighting in this environment has to be pre-calculated. It's called light baking. And I've used these white panels as the color of the light that illuminates this environment. So this environment is the lighting is pre-baked using these white panels. Now the fudge that I've done is I've given us the ability to change the color of those white panels to, you know, red and green and so on. But unfortunately the light baking still remains the white light. So it is a bit of a fudge the way that it's done here in this virtual environment. So I just felt I needed to warn you about that. But it's fun seeing the different colours, and even though it doesn't look quite right, but nevertheless, I've added it as an option. So if we go to red, and again, it kind of looks weird because it's not illuminating the room with red anymore. It's still white. So this one kind of looks fake to me. Very fake. But some of the others, the green and the peach and all that, they kind of look a little bit, they sort of feel more real in this environment. So this is the red option. And there's red. But as I said, the light illumination is still white. So if we go back to white, you can see white, and then we go to red. We have red. So then we'll try peach. And I think peach looks a little bit more natural. And if we look at our screenshots, I think there's a photo here where we, in the original TV show, we had this peach color. And so there you can see my peach color compared to their peach color, and I think it's a pretty close match. But obviously, as I said, my room is still only illuminated with white light, not peach colored light. So that's a little bit unrealistic. So that's peach, and let's have a look at orange, or more accurately, probably yellow. And the yellow looks quite nice as well. I think the worst one is the red one. It just looks so fake. So that is yellow, and then we have green. And so the green one, I think, fits in quite nicely. In fact, in here, these remain white. I wonder if I should have done those green. I've only ever seen photos of those panels as being white, but maybe if these are green, maybe that should have been green too. But I'll leave it like that for now. So that was green, and then if I turn on these screenshots again and I come down to this one here specifically, here we go. We can compare how my... Sorry, I have to reset myself in the room. We can compare how my green looks to the green colour of the screenshots. And obviously in this photo you can see the green spill light on the ceiling and floors and so on, whereas that's missing from mine. I wonder if we can find any more different coloured panels. Let's just try going up the stairs. So that's white, that's white. And these are all white. Okay, so that's all the different colours. Now the other thing, just before I go on to the next part, I was in two minds about how the extent of the green. You can see I obviously, well, the coloured panels, I obviously just restricted it to the first floor layer, and I didn't apply it to the second floor. Now, I actually never saw the second floor panels illuminated anything other than white. But what's a strange thing is that the second half of first season, when you saw the coloured panels down here, the top panels were always turned off, like always. And I wonder if something happened towards the second half of second season, because I don't know, they just didn't seem to turn on the lights on the second floor. It was kind of weird. I mean, I could be wrong. I'm sure there probably are cases where they're on, but I from memory, I think once they introduced the different colours at this level, those panels were mostly off. So I definitely never saw any coloured panels up there because they're always off, is the point that I'm trying to make. So now, if I just turn off those screen captures and go back to our corridor. So here we are in the corridor with the illuminated panels. And the illuminated panels seem to be in this configuration where the central one was coloured, but then those remained white. And then again in the TV show, you definitely see that as being coloured. You see that as being coloured as well. This, I think I had to just interpolate. I don't think I ever saw how that was configured. And here you can see I've also applied the colours inside the travel tube, but I never actually saw those colours being applied here. I just tried to apply the rule, you know, if these were green for whatever logistical reason they needed to be green, then I did the same thing here, but leaving the ceiling ones white, which is how it happened here. So if we go back to our standard white, this is how the corridor looked. And if I turn on the screen captures, you can see from the screen captures, the white paneling everywhere. And in fact, yep, the white paneling there as well. And let's just have a look at the rest of these screen captures. White paneling there. And yep, so these screen captures mostly have the white paneling except for this one here. So if I go to green, this is probably a good example, which explains the green that you see over there on the corner is exemplified there, and then they went to the white for the panels that lead in further into the doorway, which is what I did there. Obviously, this one does not have the number one on it, whereas that one does. The color contrast sometimes is a little bit awkward, so the purple and green doesn't, to my eye, doesn't really suit, but look like it does there. And when I rendered these, when I chose the color schemes, you'll see, here I've got orange and purple, but then I'll probably have to change that for the different options. So if I turn off the screen captures and then go to red, you can see I did change the color of the numbers so that you could actually see them against the background. So that's the red option, which is, I guess, appropriate for red alert. And then here we have our travel tube with the red lighting and the signage. And then if we go to peach in the travel tube, I like the peach. And then our orange, yellow, I like that one too. And then the green. And so if we come out to here, let me untangle myself. So here we have our green, and then we have our orange. And then we have our peach. And then we have our extreme red. And then we have our white. So if we have a look at this, and then we go to peach. Orange. And green. And then back to white. So those are the changes that I've done to the main mission set and the travel tube and the corridor. And so now on to the probably the major prop that I've added, which is something that I added to the launch pad. Before we go to the various launch pads, I think we'll start off with the diorama. So we go to the diorama. Okay, and in fact, that's what the diorama starts off like. So all the objects in this diorama that you can pick up and interact with start off a couple of meters above the ground and they fall into position. And then, and so here, I can, in fact, this is a bug here. So if you guys do this VR experience yourselves and notice that you can't access the corridors, so the main mission set over there, the little diorama set is there, and normally you should be able to see the corridors, but I think this is a bug. I think what's happened is the corridor, whilst it was in the off mode, probably fell right through and is now just falling into infinity. I don't know how to fix that, other than going back to a different scene, this original scene, and then back to the diorama, and then before anything can happen, oh, I did it, there it is, finally we've got it working. So to be able to, so if you're finding you can't see the corridor set, I think you may have to do that. Go back to a different scene, come back in here and swap to the corridors straight away before it has a chance to fall too far away. So we've looked at this corridor in the past. I won't spend any time in this area. But the thing that I wanted to look at is this new prop. Look at this cute little moon buggy. In fact, let me turn gravity off so that I can pick this up and let go of it and have it just float in space. It's so cute to look at it in this. So the scale of this moon buggy is in relation to the scale of the eagle. And that eagle is in correct scale to the launch pad. And the scale of this eagle, as I've mentioned before, as it says here, Eagle Transporter, 44-inch studio model. So when they were making this TV show, they had this eagle, which was 1.2-something meters long. And so that's what this is. This is 1.2 meters long, which is as big as the model was when they filmed the TV show. So that's what's determined the scale. And so this is to the same scale as this eagle. But basically, it looks like a little matchbox car at this scale. Now, so that's a moon buggy. Very cute. And then, and obviously we've seen the Conlog before. And then here we have the Hewer timing board. And so if we turn it upside down, we can see the various screws and things that are on the back of it as it screws into all these elements in the front. Various ball clips. And let's just turn gravity back on and reset everything. And in fact, if I reset it one more time, it should be correct. So that's the little matchbox version of the moon buggy. Now, the full version of the moon buggy we have over here. So let's just take a look at it from different angles. Let me untangle myself. So, okay, so this moon buggy was an ordeal to model as accurately as I could. The TV show had various versions of this moon buggy, all in different states of different amounts of this this iconography on the sides of the buggy, you know, on the back and so on. Some versions of the moon buggy had those mirrors in place, others didn't. They had the mirrors removed. Some versions of the moon buggy had this whole central region was black, and the black went over the edge here. Other versions had this. Some versions didn't have this black thing, and they didn't have this number in place. They didn't even have this rectangle, this black rectangle. Just different configurations. I almost feel like it was probably just, they seem to add new bits for each episode, and so towards the end of the season is when it looked most complex, and it was much simpler earlier on, possibly. I don't know why it was so different. And then on top of that, they, for the TV show, they had the moon buggy, their full-size moon buggy that the actors could get into and drive. But then they also had the small models, which they would place on the models of the launch pad or whatever. And from a distance, yeah, you could say, okay, that's the same moon buggy. But really, the little models were proportionally different from the real thing. And they were decked out differently with slightly different iconography stuck to the side. So when I was modeling this, I avoided the photos of the models of the moon buggy and only used the real life size versions of the moon buggy. And then on top of that, I found, because this was a real product made in the 70s, I found various YouTube pages and also various websites that featured the actual, it was called Amphicat, but they featured the actual buggy. And it appears that there were two versions of the buggy. There was an American manufactured version and a Canadian manufactured version. And from what I can tell, I think the TV show used the Canadian version of the moon buggy. Now, often it's, again, it's just so difficult to get good, clear photos of what was going on that I could then use to as reference to make my model. And so sometimes I had to use different photos of different Amphicats, and sometimes it's the American version, other times it's the Canadian version, and but all always trying to coordinate it with what was actually done in the TV show. And so so for instance, in the TV show there was never really any clear photos or images of this, the footwell here, but I found some PDF documents which had some isometric drawings, and they kind of showed a vague impression of this footwell, kind of like this. And I found one photo of the footwell that looked like this. It was difficult to get the perspective matched, so some of the proportions may not be spot on. But in the TV show, I never saw this, so I just took it upon myself to add this, because this is what was present in the proper product, in the manufactured amphibious vehicle. So, you know, there may be some artistic license that I've had to take, because, you know, I just had no clear photos from the TV show. This dash, for instance, there were different incarnations of that. Sometimes there were versions, I think, without any of this stuff, but they had that, and they had something here, roughly. They probably, some of them didn't have this, but others did. And this is that usual letter set trick that they did in the TV show, where they just stuck on some busy-looking text And they figured that no one would be able to see that on the low-resolution television screens of the 1970s. So, I mean, I never had a clear view of what this was, in fact, either, but it kind of looked like that Letraset stuff, so that's what I put in there. The version of the Amphicat, of this buggy, where this region was black, they had an entirely different dash here. This black box, they had a big black box here, and they had all sorts of busy work in here. But they did say airlock in that version as well. But it was very different to what we see here. We had versions of this where they had these different buttons, but they were up along the top edge. And then there was even another version where it was different again, and so on. So, but this was, I think, the most common one, and this is the one that I think was mostly associated with that. These are sort of stickers, which you often see that they used not only here, but they also used these stickers in some of the main mission sets as well. From a distance, they could kind of look busy, and I guess they look like maybe buttons of some kind, switches. but basically, it's stickers all around. I did have a really good photo of this, very good high-resolution photo of this. So this is spot on. It did irk me that the top text was in uppercase and the bottom was lowercase, but I had to follow what they did. The buttons, they definitely had that on there, the A and the B and whatever that symbology is supposed to be. So this is really quite accurate. The little clutch thing here, the some of the few images of the clutch were never that detailed. It was just a blurry metallic object. So I've got the proportions of it roughly, but you know, the detail is had to be made up. And then, you know, the clutch cable going through into the thing. There were definitely photos showing a hole in this metal thing where the clutch cable would go in, and they had, I think, another hole somewhere else down here, and maybe way in here, out there, and then down through the floor, I'm not sure. So this is the steering mechanism. They would brake the left tyres to go left and brake the right tyres to go right. I don't know what this object is or was. In some cases, this wasn't this U-shaped metal thing. It was a sort of like a joystick. It was a shaft with a spherical black ball on the end. I don't know what that was. Maybe it was part of the throttling mechanism for the engine, because obviously the engine was housed underneath here. In some of the photos, actually not so much in the TV show, I don't think. No, I don't remember now. I don't think I saw any in the TV show. But in the photos online for the real Amphicat, often you saw a muffler mounted in here. Yeah, because it's a petrol-powered engine, and there would be a muffler. Obviously, in science fiction, you can't have a petrol-powered air-breathing engine on the moon where there's a vacuum. But so maybe that's why they hid the muffler in the TV show. I didn't really see it there. The other thing that I sometimes saw, and again, not in the TV show, but in other versions of the Amphicat, is they would often have a cylinder mounted underneath here, which I guess would have been the petrol tank or gas or whatever was the fuel source for the engine. And so it's often you saw that mounted there. And then this was, I guess, the fuel filling cap for that tank that was mounted underneath here. But in the TV show, you never really saw that tank in this location. Well, mainly because the camera probably never got low enough, but if it did, you know, you probably saw something. But since you couldn't see it in the TV show, I didn't put anything in there for that. These buttons were... It was difficult to tell what they were. I mean, this kind of was a key thing, and these buttons kind of, you know, maybe they're a choke and maybe even its throttle mechanism. I don't know. But then other versions of the dash didn't have that anyway, so who knows. Like I mentioned before, this mirror sometimes was present and other times wasn't. And in fact, when it wasn't present, you saw the shadow or like a dirt outline in this yellow body. You saw the outline of where the mirror had been in that location. So I included the mirror because it was present a few of the times, and you can see the outline when they'd removed it. So that's mirror. This is an example. The reflection you see of the mirror is part of the fakery that you have to do in these game engines, because it's not using real-time ray tracing. If it had been using real-time ray tracing, the reflection would be perfect. But basically, the reflection that you see there is I had to place a reflection probe, and I placed it about here. And what it does is it renders a 360-degree panorama, and then that panorama is what's rendered in the reflection. So the reflection that you see here and here is actually of a reflection probe that I placed about here. So you can see when we look in the mirror, we're really looking down at the seat and at the back of the seat there, because it was rendered in this location, looking down at the seat and back of the seat. This engine cover, or cowl, or whatever, I never had a really good photo looking in this direction. I mean, there were a few kind of like this, and looking through these holes, it kind of implied those holes on the TV show. But in the some of the online stuff that I found, I think it was more clear that those holes were there. But in terms of the shape of this engine cover and so on, there were different versions. And again, I don't know if that relates to the American version and Canadian version. The different versions also, so this, you know, mechanically, this whole thing, you have these two hinges, this whole thing, in one image of this thing, I saw this whole thing pivoted up to give access to the engine. But then in other photos, I saw, instead of having hinges there, I saw hinges here and here. And so in that version, you would all pivot this way. I don't know which one was the one they used in the TV show. I think it might have been this one. Just why I did that. That little aerial thingy, never saw what was happening down there with the aerial. You could only ever see this yellow thing, and so that's roughly how high it was in the TV show. This is just sort of totally made up. And in fact, that knurling that you see there is the same knurling that we see on the launch pad, which I can probably reference later on. So that's the aerial. And let's put our head inside here. Now, I guess this is probably a water trap, because this is an amphibious vehicle. It would go in the water, and splashes would, I guess, collect down there. This is just a vague impression of some of the detail that might have been underneath this footwell. I think it's somewhat accurate, because I did find a photo which showed that the whole chassis of this without any of this shell. It was just the metal chassis, and then the axles and the tires. But we can get underneath here and have a look from inside the footwell. In the TV show, you often see two astronauts sitting in here, and so I guess, I tell you what, it must have been pretty tight for them, for the actors, to get their feet into this footwell and still kind of look natural in their spacesuits. It would have been a very tight fit, I imagine. So these are the tires. Again, you know, it was difficult to get an actual... There were different versions of the tires online. I think the photos from the TV show, they were always like this, but there might have been additional detail in here, which I kind of missed because it's just difficult to see. Now, I did go to the extra trouble of making the tires flat. So you can see this curve comes along here and then it flattens out and then it curves again. So what that means is if I was to use these, at the moment this moon buggy is static. It doesn't move. I don't know Unity well enough to be able to drive this thing around, for instance. But if the day ever comes where this becomes drivable, I just have to replace these flat bottom tires with perfectly round tires. But I added the flat bottom. You know, it's a subtle effect, but it just makes it feel like it's actually contacting the ground better. So that's that. It was a pretty close-up view of this little flag thingy and this constellations, whatever they are. So I think that's pretty close to what was done. Interestingly, and again, there were different colored combinations in different shots. They all do it differently. There's very little continuity. But this is, I think, accurate for that. Interestingly, here we go, yellow to, you know, this red, blue, green. But over here on this thing, and it definitely is, I think it definitely is like this, it's the same flag, but then the colors are reversed. So, yeah. You'd think that if it represents some sort of flag, you'd think it'd be important to have it correct, but definitely reversed to that one. Okay, so that's the moon buggy. Quite happy with how it turned out. It was a real slog to get all the details from the photos. But the final product, I'm really happy with that. And so let's have a look at it in context on the launch pad now. So if we go to the Rescue Eagle. So here we have the Rescue Eagle with our gantry that moves in and out. I did talk about possibly adding more stuff to all that cryogenic equipment over there in the distance, but I didn't do that. There's just so few photos to show what's going on. I just wasn't motivated to make it up. But here we have the moon buggy sitting next to the eagle to give it scale. And then you can imagine human beings sitting in that to give scale for the eagle. One thing about the lighting in this environment, you can see here the shadows are really, really dark in there. And even back here, actually, if I move further away, you can see you know, where the tires are, it's really dark. Although not as dark as the next scene that I'll show you. But it's really dark, and I think that's partly because it's so difficult to get ambient light filling dark regions in this environment, because the sky is black. I do have a sun, which is what does those shadows, but there's no ambient light coming from the sky, and there's no buildings that can reflect light and so on. So the fill light ends up being really dark. So that's just one thing that I wasn't. So I tried changing settings and fiddling with different options, and nothing really made a difference. So So that's one thing that is a little bit disappointing. The other thing that's a little bit disappointing with the lighting is that shadows are always difficult in game engines and in Unity, and because this scene, I have to cater to these large objects ranging, you know, 50 meters across, so the shadows have to be optimized for that. And then to try to get those settings to be appropriate for this object, which is only a couple of meters long and 1.5 meters wide, and dealing with shadows of a couple of centimeters, you end up getting these sorts of errors. So this is a light baking error that you can see in here. I mean, it's fixable with optimized settings for an object of this scale, but then the shadows on that would be wrong. So, yeah, I don't know. I don't know how to do it any better. I mean, somebody who knows Unity better than me might be able to. And also, in the future, if we ever have real-time ray tracing, then that problem will totally go away too. It would be interesting to... A few times I've tried to look at the Unreal game engine as an option instead of using Unity, which is what this is created in. I found it difficult to wrap my head around Unreal, but it would be interesting to see how the Unreal game engine handles these sorts of situations where you have large objects and small objects and then the shadows working. Unreal 5 looks very promising for that sort of stuff. So if we teleport up to here, so from the perspective of an astronaut in fact, I can even put my head in. Oh, no, I can't. It's closed. So from up here, looking down at the moon buggy, we see that sort of proportion. And let's come up here on the roof and see the moon buggy sitting there. Very dark, unfortunately. I haven't done this for a while in these walkthroughs, but let's turn on the afterburners. So we can see those little vernier jets coming on, and we can see the afterburners over there. And then if I go turn off the engine coolant, you can see down here, engine coolant has stopped. And then if we turn off that stopped as well. Okay, so that's enough of this environment. Let's have a look at the VIP Eagle. So here we are. So again, this is mostly unchanged, except for the addition of the moon buggy up there. And again, here the moon buggy, the shadows are really dark. So not only do we have a black sky, we now have a black floor, so there's very little bounce light to illuminate the nooks and crannies of this thing. And here you can see one of those bugs with the lighting where it just can't handle the overall scale of the large environment compared to the small detail of this object. So this is a, so again, like with the others, this is a static object with baked lighting, but we've got these objects which we can pick up and throw around, and they can interact with the thing. Now, in terms of collision, the collision mesh is accurate for most of this buggy, except for this aerial. So if I drop this, the aerial has a collision mesh to this point here. I basically didn't want the collision mesh for the aerial to extend past this height here, because in the diorama scene where you've got that little matchbox version, and I could have done a separate collision mesh for the matchbox, but I didn't want to. I wanted to use the same collision mesh. It seemed strange to me to have the matchbox when it's when it's upside down and falls on the ground, to have it the whole weight of the moon buggy pivot on this flimsy little aerial. So I deliberately didn't do a collision mesh that goes all the way up to the top, because I wanted the little matchbox car to, and when it falls on its roof, to actually fall onto, take all the weight on this region rather than take the whole weight of the car on the tip of that flimsy fiberglass aerial. So this is the moon buggy sitting on the launch pad. And so often you saw these things in the back of the moon buggy. And if we come here, in fact, if I go there, right now we're standing on the top of this structure. There's the moon buggy, there's the eagle, gantry, and too weak. Way too weak. So, okay, I think that's all for this update. At this point, I don't know what I'll be working on next for the next update. We will just have to wait and see. So till next time, thanks for watching. Bye.